color. Let's bring in the Hall of Famer, David Aldridge, who's been covering this story for us on NBA.com. DA, let's get the latest here and focus in on Chris Paul going to Houston as the Players Union president, a guy who helped fight for the over 36 rule to be changed to now the over 38 rule. What was the talks of him and the Clippers and that five-year deal that would have made him very handsomely paid?
Well, look, Jared, that's the crux of it as far as the Clippers are concerned. Chris Paul's 32 years old. He'll be 37 if they gave him a five-year deal. At the end of that contract, you'd have to pay him almost $45 million. He'd be getting a max deal. You know, it's slightly less than it would have been with the cap going down a little bit, so it's a little less than $200 million right now, but it's still real close to $200 million. So the idea of paying anybody that's not named LeBron James or maybe Kevin Durant almost $45 million at age 37 is just not something that the Clippers were comfortable with. And I think we've seen this a couple of times now with teams that had the choice of paying a guy that ultra max, that veterans, designated veteran player max. We saw it with Sacramento. They said they're going to pay DeMarcus Cousins, and then when push came to shove, they moved him. And now we see the same thing with the Clippers. They just didn't feel comfortable doing that. I don't think they wanted to do it. I think it helps them in maybe a little bit, but a little bit's better than none in terms of being able to keep Blake Griffin as well. It was going to be real difficult for them going forward to have two max contracts. You're talking about more than $100 million in tax down the road. And Steve Ballmer, would he have paid it? He probably would have, but I don't know if they'd be any closer to winning than they were this year, when Chris Paul's a year younger than he'll be next year. So that was their perspective. From Houston's perspective, it makes sense in this regard. We saw what happened with James Harden. He had an incredible regular season. He had an incredible career numbers across the board. Certainly could have been MVP. Had an MVP caliber season. But then in the playoffs, when teams could concentrate on him and they could really get gang up on him, he really seemed to struggle. When teams really got into him, doubled him, trapped him, made him give up the ball, that was a problem for this team. And I think now adding Chris Paul gives them another facilitator. Patrick Beverley is a pretty good spot-up shooter. He's an outstanding defender on the ball, but not the facilitator that you probably need when the playoffs come and defenses say, hey, we're going to take this ball handler away and we're going to make somebody else make a play. Now with Chris Paul, obviously you have somebody else. Whether he's on the ball or coming off the ball, you have somebody else that can make a play if they double Harden and vice versa.
Wow. What a big story today. Chris Paul heading to Houston, paired in the backcourt with James Harden. The Hall of Famer, David Aldridge, have much more on NBA.com. Thanks for joining us, DA. All right, guys, sure. Let's bring in Sekou and 3D here. Let's talk here of, we've heard of dissension with the Clippers players. Now an ESPN report that maybe Chris Paul and Doc Rivers weren't as cohesive as we thought, or on the same page as we thought maybe they were.
Yeah, and I think you got to be careful with those things. It always comes out after the fact, Jared, 3D. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is the business DA talked about. Yeah. You're talking about a 37-year-old Chris Paul making that kind of money. If you're the Clippers and you're talking about competing at the highest level in the future, there's no way you can make those numbers work, even for a guy with pockets as deep as Steve Ballmer. How much of that tax are you willing to pay? Mm. You know, and to pay that tax without competing for a title, I mean, I think is untenable. So I would push back just a little bit on this idea that, you know, the relationship between CP3 and Doc was, you know, deteriorated to the point they couldn't work together anymore. I'm sure if it was a different financial circumstance, they'd have found a way to keep winning games and putting themselves in a position to be a playoff team in the Western Conference.
All right, 3D, the relationship now with Harden and CP3, two guys who dribble the ball and need the ball in their hands a whole lot.
Yeah, they do. But I think for all the reports you hear, I think Chris Paul's willing now to give the basketball and get on the weak side of the floor and be what we call a catch-and-shoot player. And I think that's the bottom line. Depending on who you talk to and all the people out here with all the reports say that now if the Houston Rockets have, say, 100 possessions, well, you know James Harden was initiating 80 of those possessions. So now Chris Paul has to be on the weak side of the floor and be ready to be a catch-and-shoot player. The three-point numbers, yes, are better than Patrick Beverley's, but let's take it. The ball's normally in your hands. You get into a rhythm. Now you're taking that shot with the shot clock going down. Now James Harden is initiating the offense. Now you're on that swing. The shot clock's with 6 seconds on the shot clock. Now you got to either get a shot right away or be ready to catch and shoot. Little things like that you have to work out. Obviously, the defensive stuff a lot of people are going to talk about. But the bottom line is, to your point, Jared, both guys like to massage the basketball.
Did he say they're going to shoot with 6 seconds left on the shot clock? Like D'Antoni is going to
scratch his head, right?
Seconds, get rid of the ball, shoot it. We get to the very latest on Phil Jackson when we come back.